All right, so in the last class we were talking about the concept of pipelining. So what we are going to do now is look a little bit deeper into the idea behind pipelining. What are the conditions under which pipelining is permitted, how we should go about systematically doing it, and then extend it to the case where there may be feedback present in the circuit. So in other words, there are loops present in the circuit. You cannot apply direct pipelining the way that we discussed it last time. So what are the constraints and how do we handle such a situation? Okay. So before we get into the discussion of how exactly we should systematically do pipelining, right, let us look at an example of what we mean by a time invariant system, right? Because one of the constraints that is required for pipelining to be applicable in a scenario is that the individual modules that are performing computations need to be time invariant. Their functionality should not change with time, right? In other words, supposing a computation that we are doing is y of n is some function of x of n, and I replace x of n with some other x prime of n, right? Not exactly with x prime of n, with some x of n minus k, the question is what happens as a result, right? What do I get on the y output, okay? And the requirement is that I should essentially end up getting y of n minus k. Okay, so it's easiest to understand what we mean over here by taking a counter example, a case where this condition is not satisfied, right? Supposing y of n is a function n times x of n. Okay, what that basically means is there is a multiplication module whose input is the sequence x of n. Another input to that same multiplication module is n itself. Okay, it's a measure of the instantaneous time. It is some counter that's keeping track of time. That is what is given as the input. And what we get over here is y of n. Okay, now if I replace x of n by x of n minus 1, right, what I am actually effectively saying over here is that this input to the multiplier, right, is going to be replaced by a delayed version. I have x of n and over here I have x of n minus 1, but otherwise the multiplier, the other input, remains the same. It is n that does not change to n minus 1 because I have inserted a delay only on the branch involving x of n. Okay, these two are clearly not the same. Okay, and this is an example of a case where essentially this pipelining is not possible. Okay, in other words, this n times x of n is one particular example of something which is not time invariant. The value of n itself is used as one of the inputs to the multiplier, as the coefficient over there. Okay, which means that as time goes on, the actual value which is used for multiplying the x of n is dependent on that particular value of time itself. Okay, so there are certain examples of this sort where you can see that pipelining will not work. The simplest way of looking at it is, as long as the inputs themselves to your individual computational modules are time invariant, right? So what it means is that if I have a computational module which has some inputs, let's say x1 of n, x2 of n, and it has some outputs, y1 of n, y2 of n, right? As long as I can introduce delaying the inputs, right, if this is what I have done, right, I get some outputs, right? In this case, as long as what I'm going to get is y1 of n minus 1 and y2 of n minus 1, then this is essentially an acceptable transformation. Okay. In general, for a lot of cases, especially for signal processing type of applications, this is true. So it's not something very difficult to manage. Okay. So assuming, so for example, adders, right? As long as I'm adding two inputs that can change with time, but are themselves not dependent on the value of the time variable, so to say, right? In other words, if I shift my entire sequence by one time unit, delay it, all that will happen is the output will also get delayed by the same time unit. Okay, if that is the case, then this kind of pipelining, right, inserting a register at some point is acceptable. Okay, so now to sort of, let's move forward from here and take a slightly more complex example of a system which we are looking at a hardware implementation, right? And then go forward with it and sort of see, okay, how do we do the analysis of this? What is the best throughput that we can get? And thereafter, how do I use pipelining in order to improve the throughput that I can achieve with this system? Okay. So the example that I'm going to take is a completely artificial contrived example. I'm just going to write node names over here. They do not correspond to any, they need not be adders or multipliers. They can be any arbitrary computational units. Okay. I'm just going to call them A, B, C, D, etc. Okay. So this is some arbitrary data flow graph. Okay, like I said, the actual computations being performed by A, B, C, D, etc., I don't care about. All that I care is they take certain inputs if necessary. I mean, so A, for example, does not take inputs, but it does generate outputs. All the others, B, C, etc., take some inputs and generate outputs. Okay, the assumption I'm going to make further over here is that DA is equal to DB, etc., all of them have the same delay value equal to one time unit. Okay. Again, like I said, that time unit is irrelevant. It could be one clock cycle, it could be one nanosecond, it could be any time unit, as long as I'm consistent in the comparisons that I'm doing across all the different implementations. Okay, so this is what I have, right? And let's say I have, as far as my hardware is concerned, I have separate hardware modules for implementing A, B, C, D, E, and F. Okay, so there are six pieces of hardware, right, that are capable of implementing this. Each of those hardware units essentially takes this one time unit to execute its particular function. Okay, and as a result, and you can even think of these as combinational gates, AND gates, OR gates if you want to. Okay, therefore, if I now ask the question, if I consider this entire system as one unit, what is the critical path and therefore the best iteration period that I can get for this implementation, right? What would you say is the critical path through the circuit? How many time units? Shout one number. What is the critical path? It's the longest path through this circuit. Okay, so in this particular case, if I start looking for the critical path, what I'll find is that there is one path over here which starts from A, goes to E, goes up to C, comes to F, and then to D. Okay, and this path essentially has a length which is 5 time units. Okay, so in other words, what it's saying is, once I have triggered the execution of A, right, in this case, I don't have any inputs going into A, but if I did have inputs, then something happens, A executes, it generates outputs. Those then go, you know, those outputs are copied to B and E. B and E then execute because they are after all working on separate pieces of hardware, right? They generate their outputs that are then in turn consumed by C, and then once C has also finished is only when I can run F, okay? So even though the output of E might be ready at time 2, right, F cannot directly execute then because it's still waiting for something from C, right? So this is exactly the notion of critical path, right? And ultimately it determines what is the minimum clock period or iteration period that I can use for this, okay? Just for reference, what should the iteration period bound of this circuit be? What is the iteration period bound? Going back to what we discussed last week, the iteration period bound is the minimum achievable theoretical iteration period. I mean, even in theory, assuming infinite hardware, what is the minimum iteration period that can be achieved for this circuit? Huh? Zero, right? There are no loops over here, so there are no feedback loops. This is an example of something that's completely feed forward. If I have sufficient amount of hardware, right, it's just like the case of the FIR filter, I could take all my x of n values, my inputs, and feed them into infinite number of copies of A. Those outputs will then feed into infinite copies of n copies of B and C, B and E, then C, F, D, right, in that sequence, which means that within 5 time units I could basically finish n iterations. As n tends to infinity, the iteration period could be brought down as low as I wanted if I had infinite hardware. So the theoretical bound over here is zero, okay? But the practical bound is going to be obviously very different because I have only one piece of hardware each for A, B, C, D, E, and F, okay? So one way of looking at that is A by itself imposes a loop, right? I can think of it basically as having a self loop over here with one delay element saying that only after A has finished once, it can then start again on the next iteration, okay? And if I had this kind of a self loop on each and every one of my operations or my hardware units, now what would the iteration period bound be? I have loops. There is a loop around A. The loop delay through it, the total execution delay is DA equal to 1 time unit. The number of tokens on it is 1. Therefore, the iteration bound as far as the loop around A is concerned is 1. Okay, so in other words, for the green version, the iteration period bound is going to be max of in other words 1 time unit. Okay, so as long as I have only one piece of hardware for each of these units of execution, that is A, B, C, D, E, and F, I am limited to at best having one time unit as my minimum iteration period. Okay, all right. So right now what we have seen is the critical path of the circuit as it stands, which is marked in magenta over here, is 5 time units. The question I'm asking is, if I want to bring it down, I mean, in theory, I can bring it down all the way to zero if I have infinite hardware. Even if I don't have infinite hardware, I have only these resources, my iteration period bound is still 1. It's not 5. Okay, so 5 is clearly much more than what I should be looking at. Okay, if I wanted to bring my iteration period down to 3, the clock period that I can use for this, how would I go about doing it? Okay, so let's just redraw this very quickly so that it becomes a bit clearer. Okay, so the first thing is that the critical path, if I write down the nodes on the critical path, what are they? It's going to be A, E, C, F and D, right, for a total of 5 time units. If I want to bring down the length of the critical path, the number of nodes or the total execution time delay on that critical path to 3 or less, how can I do this? I need to break this path. I cannot have AECFD as one long path through the circuit. I can break it. Where should I break it? Huh? In other words, in this particular case, there are, if I break it between A and E, for example, will it help? No, I mean, that by itself will not bring down the critical path below 3 or to 3, right? In other words, if I was to go and put a break over here, then I would get 1 and 4, which is not really solving my problem, okay? Instead, if I put a break here, I would get 2 over here and 3 on this side, which is one possibility. If I break it here, I would get 3 on this side and 2 on this side, which is also okay. But if I break it here, I would get 4 on this side and 1 on this side, which is again not solving my problem, okay? Right? So one of these two is possibly what I'm going to be looking at, right? Either I break the critical path between E and C or between C and F. Okay, so let's consider the possibility that I'm going to break the critical path here. And breaking the critical path, essentially, as far as I'm concerned, involves introducing a register. Okay, now comes the question, is this sufficient? Can I just do whatever I have done now, which is breaking this path between E and C, right? If I don't change anything else and just introduce one register over there, I am changing the functionality of my entire circuit, right? If you think in terms of a transfer function, the output transfer function will change. It will no longer be what I expected it to be. It will not just be a sort of delayed version of the input or of the expected output. It will have completely different characteristics, okay? If I don't want this to happen, what should I do? I need to also make sure that all the paths which are leading from A to D have the same amount of delay on them. Okay? There are multiple ways of doing this, right? So what would be the obvious one? Also introduce delays on B, C and EF, right? So this, for example, would solve the problem for me, right? If I also introduce registers here and here, now what I get is my critical path effectively becomes this, okay? Right? Just to sort of take a slightly different approach on this, you know, let's also redraw this slightly and say what happens if I had chosen a slightly different place, a way in which to do the partitioning. In other words, I decided to go ahead and put a register over here, that's fine, okay? I could also have chosen to partition here, in other words, put a register between A and B and between E and F, okay? In other words, all that I'm saying is this is a valid pipelining transformation. Will this solve my problem? Not really, because what will happen over here is I will end up getting the slightly longer critical path over here. Okay? But this is still a valid pipelining. Okay. On the other hand, something like this, right? Where I essentially say I would introduce a register here, and a register here, right? This is okay from a critical path point of view, right? Because after all, the critical path now has essentially become this or this. Both of them are equal to 3, right? But there is a problem. Right, and the problem is simply that what I did over here is invalid. Okay, right, how do I understand exactly the problem that I have over here? You can look at it like this. Effectively, if I redraw this, right, and I just put A, B, and C, which are all the nodes on one side of my pipelining, right, versus D, E, and F over here, right? What are the edges that I have? I have an edge from A to B, one from B to C. There is one edge which has been cut from A to E, that's fine. There is also something going from E to C, okay, something from C to F, and from C to D, okay. So actually speaking, I mean, so the problem is not really on the C to F node, the problem is on the C to E node that I have over here. Right? So what you can see over here is this node is going in the opposite direction. Right? In other words, this is not a so-called feed-forward cut set, okay? So once again, to reiterate, what exactly is a cut set? It is a set of the edges in this graph, which if I remove those edges, will divide the graph completely into two independent subgraphs, okay? Just to sort of complete this, there is E to F and F to E. Yeah, so you can see that if over here, if I remove all the red edges, right, the ABC part of it has edges in between the ABC portion, the DEF part has some edges that are in between the DEF nodes. Anything which is in between these two subgraphs or subsets has to go, is already part of this cut set that I have chosen for removal. Okay, so that's number one, that's the definition of a cut set. It has to divide the overall graph into two completely disjoint portions. Okay, the second thing is, in this case, for valid pipelining, I need it to be a feed forward cut set. Okay, everything has to go in one direction. If I redraw the graph so that the direction of the edges is clear, all of them should go either from left to right or from right to left. Okay. So this last one that I have over here, in other words, is an invalid pipelining. I cannot use this kind of approach, but as long as I can pick out a valid feed forward cut set, I can do pipelining on it. Okay. So let's take this idea of pipelining one step further. By doing this, in other words, I was able to So this pipelining that we have shown over here, right, where we had the set of nodes, the BC, EC and EF edges are removed, right? It's sort of very clear even just by looking at it that this forms a cut set. It basically divides the graph into two portions, ABE on the left hand side and CFD on the right hand side. And anything which is going between these two sides has been removed as part of the cut set. Okay. And the critical path as a result has come down to 3. Okay. So this was the first cut that we wanted. We were able to bring the critical path down to 3. What if I want to go further? What if I want to bring the critical path all the way down to, let's say, 1? Okay. How should I go about doing it? I can pretty much just repeat the process that I have discussed over here. Right? So what it would look like is, every pair of nodes in this graph needs to have at least one register on the edge between them. Okay. So how do I go about doing that? This is, for example, one valid cut set. So far, so good, right? So now these three edges, BC, EC and EF, have registers on them. Okay. I can go further and say, add this. This is also a valid feed forward cut set. What it has done is basically taken A onto the left hand side, everything else onto the right, and anything connecting from A to the rest of the graph has a delay element, is part of the cut set, and therefore has a delay element introduced on it. Okay. Similarly, I can do this. Okay. Looks good. Have I achieved what I wanted? Not yet. There is still this C to F edge, right? So the critical path right now basically becomes the C to F edge. That is the node C followed by node F, each of which has a delay of 1 time unit. Therefore, total critical path is 2 time units. I want to reduce it to 1. Okay. So if I want to do that, what will happen? I need to essentially introduce this register somewhere here. But now I have to make sure that it is a complete feed forward cut set, right? I also, and I can choose this as an example of a valid feed forward cut set. Okay. So CD, CF, EF is a valid feed forward cut set. If you redraw it, you will see that everything goes from the left hand side because A, B, C and E are on the left, D and F are on the right. All these three edges, C, D, C, F and E, F, cross over from left to right. Okay, so it is a valid feed forward cut set. And by doing this, I have now managed to introduce at least one register on every edge. The important thing is that it is at least one, because if I look at both of these, right, they both have two registers introduced on them. And that is important. Just the fact that I introduced a register over there for doing an earlier pipelining is not sufficient. If I also want to break the C to F edge, right, I still need to pick out a separate, I need to look at the original graph and pick out a whole new set of edges and once again do the entire cut set part of it for them. Just the fact that while I was pipelining the BC, EC, EF, right, I introduced a register on the EF edge is not sufficient. if I want to break C to F, I need to introduce one more register on EF. Okay, so it is possible that I end up with multiple different registers to be introduced on a single edge. What is happening? They essentially just end up acting as a shift register. All that is happening is on one clock cycle, the data goes from the source, that is E, into one of the registers. On the next clock cycle, it goes from that register to the next register. And on the third clock cycle, it goes from that register to F, where the computation is done. Okay. So in other words, some of these registers are just sort of placeholders. They are holding data for some time until they are ready to be accepted by the next stage, and making sure that the path delays, the number of registers on every path when I go from input to output, are the same. Okay. So once I have done this, I will end up effectively with a critical path which is equal to 1 in this case, after all of these registers have been added. Okay. So in general, that's all there is to it. Pipelining by itself is a fairly simple process. If I wanted to do it in general, right, let's just take a simple chain. Right, and let's say that the execution times of these are something like 5 time units, 10 time units, 25 time units, and once again 10 time units. Okay, right now the critical path is how much? It's 5 plus 10, 15, 25, 40, 50 time units. Okay, what is the minimum that I can get to if I cannot add any extra hardware other than registers? 25. Okay, so my bottleneck in this case is ultimately going to be this node, which has the maximum delay. Right, it becomes a bottleneck because that is the slowest unit in my pipeline. Okay, and how do I go about pipelining over here in order to actually get my critical path down to 25? It basically means that this unit C cannot be combined with any other unit in the same clock cycle or in the same iteration interval, right? Because the moment I add some other functionality, the delay is the critical path delay is going to go above 25. So one thing that is obviously guaranteed is I need to have a register here and a register here, which now tells me that although I could have added a register between A and B, that's unnecessary because it does not really help me in any way. My critical path has already come down to 25 and the AB delay is only 15, right? So adding an extra register at AB is not wrong. There's no problem with it. Functionally, you will be perfectly fine, but is unnecessary in this case. Okay. How do you solve this problem in general? There are systematic ways of doing this, right? I'm not going to go into that because one is that those processes can be automated and most tools nowadays will take care of this for you, the fine-grained pipelining details. But if you do need to do pipelining by hand, usually it will be in a situation where the circuit is simple enough and you can visually observe that this is going to be the critical path, this is the portion I need to isolate, and the rest of the things I put in whatever are the minimum number of registers I need in order to make sure the critical path does not exceed my target. Okay. Usually this is also called balancing, right? What you want to do is, if I want to break my circuit into two parts or three parts, I try and balance things out so that the delays are pretty much equalized on all sides. Okay. In this particular instance, supposing I had told you that you are allowed to only use one extra register, right? What would you do? What's the best that you can do? Where would you place that register? That is, if only one extra register is permitted, where should you place it to minimize the critical path? With the same delay, so 5, 10, 25, 10. Okay, either I can I can put a register either on the edge between A and B, or between B and C, or between C and D. That's it. Those are my three options. Where should I place it? In this case, between B and C would be the only sensible place to put it, right? So I end up with 35 on this side, 15 on this side. Not balanced, but at least better than any of the other options, because for example, if I had put it here, this would have been 5 and 45, or if I had put it over here, I would have ended up with 40 and 10, right? So this one happens to be the best. Okay, so depending on what, how many registers you are willing to invest or spend on pipelining, you can decide how much improvement in your critical path you want to achieve. Okay, so if you have more registers available to you, you may want to do additional pipelining. Okay, there is a flip side to this, which is that registers don't come for free. One is they occupy area. The second thing is, the part that I'm not mentioning at all, or that I've not shown over here, is registers themselves have a certain capacitance associated with them, which means that they have a propagation delay on their input side, the so-called clock to queue, or on the output side is the clock to queue output delay of the register, and on the input side they have a setup delay, right? So each time I add a register over there, that is also going to become additional overhead, and therefore the reduction in critical path that I get may not be as much as I expect it to be. So once I have got down to the point where my critical path itself is of a similar order to the clock to queue or setup delays of a register, you are not really going to get any further improvements by pipelining. Okay? All right. All of this works in the situation where my data flow graph is feed forward. Okay? So the natural question that arises is, what happens if I have feedback in my circuit? How should I handle it? Right? So an example of that is, right, something like this. Okay, let's say DA is equal to 1, DB is equal to 1. Okay, the iteration period bound in this case is going to be how much? This has a loop, therefore there is an iteration period bound which is not 0, and in this case it is going to be how much? 2 time units. Okay, what is the critical path through this? Also equal to 2 time units. It's basically the delay through A and B. In other words, if I was directly implementing this using hardware and that delay element was implemented as a hardware register, then the propagation delay through A plus the propagation delay through B is the critical path. Okay? So my critical path has now become equal to iteration period bound. It looks as though I really can't do anything to improve this. And that is correct. I cannot do anything to improve this. Okay, that is the whole point of defining that iteration period bound. There is nothing as such that I can do. There are some tricks that may be applicable under certain conditions, but in general, for a signal processing application, you can't do anything further. The moment your critical path has hit your iteration period bound, that's it. You might as well stop trying to improve on it. If you are not meeting your throughput constraints, you need to relook at your algorithm or your hardware technology itself. Okay. Now, even though this has already hit the critical path, there is one thing that we can observe from this which is useful to understand, which is that this and this, I mean the two graphs that I've drawn over here, are essentially the same. Okay. Same except for the delay unit, right? And what we can essentially say over here is that one is a so-called retimed version of the other, What I mean by retiming, in other words, is let's say that I had a functional node which looks like this, and it has a delay on its output, right? These two I claim are essentially the same thing, which is pretty much what I started off with at the beginning of this lecture by saying that time invariant systems, right? The fact that I have shifted a register from the output side to the input side, right, does not change the functionality that is finally going to be observed. If this condition is true, right, then we can actually generalize the idea of pipelining somewhat, because now I can basically look at isolated nodes and decide whether or not I can move registers across them. Okay, in particular, I can extend this further and say that supposing A had some number of inputs and some outputs, okay, and let's say that it had registers, at least one register on each of its inputs, or just for clarity, let's also add one more register over here. Right? A retiming step could involve something like this. I will take one set of registers from each of these from input nodes and put them to the output. Okay? So what would happen is, on the output side, I would end up with one register on each of the output edges. On the first incoming edge to A, there was one register to start with, now there will be zero. On the second one, there were three to start with, that reduces to two. And on the third one, there were two to start with, that reduces to one. Okay? So the claim is that these two versions of the graph are exactly the same. They are performing the same computation. Okay? And anybody who is outside of this box that I draw over here cannot tell the difference. Right? Anybody who is observing it from outside this boundary cannot tell the difference that there has been some movement of registers around the functional units inside. Okay? And that is actually quite a powerful claim, because effectively what it's telling you is you can now look at a part of a graph, do some retiming on it without having to worry about what the rest of the graph looked like. Okay? And the fact that you have made this isolated change over here can in turn impact the critical path through the entire circuit. Okay? An example of that is a very similar graph to the one that I showed earlier. But now, let's say it has two delays instead of one. Okay? Right now, what's the critical path? It's two time units. What's the iteration period bound? The total execution delay DA plus DB is equal to 2, but the number of tokens on that loop is also 2. Therefore, the iteration period bound is 2 by 2 equal to 1. Okay? And if I now retime this, what I can get is one delay over here, one delay over here, right? And my critical path now becomes equal to 1, which is equal to the IPP. Okay? So this is a simple way by which I can use retiming right? It's something very similar to the idea of pipelining, but applies for circuits with feedback, right? If I look at this, what have I actually done over here? I've essentially taken this as my cut set. Is it a feedforward cut set? No, because one edge goes from A to B and the other edge goes from B to A, right? But I have still applied movement of registers across this cut set, right? Effectively, the way that you can look at it now is I can choose any cut set. It need not be feed forward alone. It's just that in one direction, if I am adding registers, in the other direction, I should be able to subtract registers, right? So in other words, for this direction, I do plus 1. In this direction, I do minus 1. And that's what has happened, right? The A to B edge, which had 0 registers on it, I did plus 1 and it ended up with 1 register. The B to A edge, which is going backwards, had 2 registers on it, I do minus 1 and it becomes 1 register on it. Okay? So, how is this useful? Very simple. Right now, the critical path has reduced from 2 to 1. If this circuit was part of a larger system, there also it's quite possible that moving this register into a different location could have given me an improvement in my critical path. Okay. One last thing before we stop for today's class. One observation that we can make from this transformation that I showed over here, right? What is the total number of registers that I have over here on my original graph? 1 plus 3 plus 2, 6. What about here? 2 plus 1 on the input, plus 1 plus 1 on the output. 5. Okay. So, in other words, the retiming operation does not necessarily preserve the number of registers that are present in the circuit. Why did this happen? Because I had 3 input edges, 2 output edges. So when I moved a register from the input side to the, moved a set of registers from the input side to the output side, the required number of registers reduced. I have only 2 output edges. Okay? You could potentially make use of this. Let's say that your critical path was no longer your concern, right? You are operating at a stage where speed is taken care of. You are anyway able to meet your speed. Okay? Why would you then want to do a retiming of this sort? You can reduce the number of registers, which in turn could translate possibly into a reduction in hardware and therefore reduction of area. Okay? So, in other words, the bottom line is this. Retiming by itself is just a transformation. All that it says is, under what conditions are you allowed to move registers from input of a computational node to the output? Okay? If you do it completely on feed forward cut sets, it is a sort of simplified version that's called pipelining and is very commonly used. Okay? It can be applied in general for circuits that have feedback as well, provided that these conditions are satisfied, that anything going in one direction, if you are increasing the number of registers, in the opposite direction, you need to decrease the number of registers, right? And at any point in time, the number of registers on a given edge cannot become negative, right? Under those constraints, it is possible to set up complete optimizations. You could either try to optimize the critical path, right? And therefore the speed at which the system operates, or you can try and optimize the total number of registers present in the circuit, which in turn is related to the area occupied by the circuit, right? Or in some cases you might even have some other combination of these, right? Some other metric that you are interested in, which is the sort of balancing. How are you, where are you able to place the registers, in which part of the circuit do the registers go, and how are you able to use them, right? So it's possible to set up different kinds of optimization problems depending on the cost condition that you want to optimize for. Okay, the retiming by itself is just the basic transformation, the concept that allows you to do this movement of registers that you can then use systematically. Okay, all right, we'll stop here for